We are celebrating our 9-year anniversary.
Our families are the bedrock of the society.
Right.
When families fall apart, society falls into social and cultural.
And the man has to take the high road all the time. When the man is out of sin, when the woman wants to play the role of the man, that's the problem.
So if you are married, you have another job.
Oh, snap. I have to think about her. Like, would she want me to spend this money this way? Does she need something first? Like, it's no longer about me. It's about her.
The man's role is service. The woman is to submit to the man. But the man is to serve the woman.
You know, on the day of wedding, you are smiling, dancing. And after wedding, you're thinking that's the way it's going to be. You know, after that, you start the walk. So it's a walk. It's not just a celebration.
Okay, guys, happy Sunday.
Yes, happy Sunday, everybody. We're excited that you're here for our 9-year anniversary. We are excited to be here. What a beautiful Sunday. What a beautiful Sunday. Thank you all for coming in. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you. I'm excited. You want to say something, baby? What do you want to say to our guests today?
Well, I am so excited that you guys are here. Thank you so much for coming to celebrate with us. You know that it's going to be awesome.
Yes, yes. Thank you all our big uncles. I mean, this was not planned. It was just 3 days party. Like, we started planning 3 days or 4 days ago, you know, and the beautiful thing is that all our guest speakers, the people that we want to share, you know, something today, you know, if I call the person, each time I call each of them, they all said yes, yes, yes. And I said, this is God. So we are excited to be here. We're excited. What a beautiful day. What a beautiful day. So we're going to get this party started with a word of prayer. Okay. Heavenly Father, we thank you because you are awesome. And thank you for as many that are joining on Facebook. We just want to thank you for everyone here. Lord, we pray, God, in heaven that your presence is already here. And we ask, oh God, that through our story, through our testimony, through other people's testimony, that homes, families will be healed. We just thank you. We want to tell you, Lord, that we love you and we celebrate you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen. Amen.
You all are so beautiful.
Amen. Thank you.
Yes. All right. So, honey, what do we have today? What are we doing today?
Well, we are celebrating our 9-year anniversary, and then we invite all of you to come celebrate with us. And we also want to have this opportunity to be able to encourage others, other families. And we have our big daddy here that will be speaking to us. And we are just excited that you're here, daddy.
And also we have some friends. I have a pastor friend joining from Nigeria. Dr. Anyoko is joining us. He is live here. And I tell you, he's going to be a beautiful one. And I have a friend too who was supposed to be one of the guests. I just got a call from him. You know, things are still like a little bit, so he may join us down the line. You know, I was his best man during his wedding, so I'm hoping that he will get in. But in any case, he's not able to make it, we'll roll on. We have all the guests apart from him. We have Opie Van. They are here live.
Yes, you know, yes, awesome.
Yes, yes. So let's roll. Yeah, so the first thing we want to look at today, like we said, we are celebrating our 9-year anniversary, you know, what God has done, the beautiful story of how God brought us together. And we are just learning and understanding that this is work, you know. So if you are married, you have another job apart from your regular job. So it's a walk. It's not just a celebration. You know, on the day of wedding, you are smiling, dancing. And after wedding, you're thinking that's the way it's going to be. You know, after that, you start the walk. So we want to share a little bit of our story and what prompted what we are doing. Actually, like 6 months into our marriage, I one day asked my wife, I said, I don't want to leave and die trying to stay married. And I said to her, I mean, divorce is not an option, but unfortunately, if you want divorce, I'm ready for it. Don't be surprised. This is a youth pastor, someone who has been in the ministry helping young people. And I just felt like I can't make this work. But guess what? After 9 years, we are still moving on. So, amen. Baby, do you want divorce? So it's just to tell you what God can do. So if you are struggling, if your marriage is struggling, if you are dealing with difficult time in your marriage, it just simply means that God can fix something. There is something missing, and you need to understand what is missing and just get it fixed. Don't make divorce your option. That is not an option, because it leaves people bruised and, you know, like bruises, and you just can't get yourself back. So today we want to dive in into our program. We are excited to at this time bring in our daddy, who will be the one they're gonna be talking to us. So I'm gonna let my wife run the question and answer section, and he's gonna be taking us on a treat. It's gonna be like a question, but he will also be ministering to us. We are talking about broken home, broken society. We complain about the society we live in. We complain about how things are rough, how things are not good. But we all come from a home. And until we begin to take responsibility to know that we need to fix our home before we talk about the society, we need to, you know, run the home as a kingdom that God has given to us, things will not change in the society. So today, we don't have a formal, you know, I'm sorry about that, daddy. We're not going into, you know, formal kind of introduction, but he is our daddy, and I hope he understands. When next we bring you to this platform, we'll do justice to that. All right, baby, right on.
All right, thank you so much, daddy, mommy, Lizzie, for joining us today. We are just super excited that you honored this invitation. More than anything. Right. I'm going to go ahead and, can you unmute yourself? Okay, great. Awesome. So, you know, when you hear about broken homes, broken society, what is it that comes to your mind? You know, when they say, like, as family goes, so society goes. Families are the bedrock of the society. Right. When families fall apart, society falls into social and cultural decline. So when you hear about, you know, this statement, what is it that, you know, that comes to your mind?
I'm going to let my wife go first. So we just want to start by saying, what is a what does a normal home look like? Before I talk about a broken home, what is God's order? So we are going. I have my wife to go ahead and talk about that, and then we'll follow up your question thereafter.
Okay, awesome. Great.
Hey, good day, everyone.
This Michael. Is-
Hey, Michael, hey, man them and them over there. First of all, before I start saying something, I know when we are growing up, before I got married in my ministry of Scripture Union, there's a song that we usually sing that says, when Jesus in the family, happy, happy home. But Jesus is not in that family, it's crisis everywhere. So I'm not going to sing that song. But we're talking about broken home. Most of 90% of broken homes, you will see that Christ is not in that home. And when Christ is not in that home, it's crisis. Mm-hmm. So I want to talk about broken home. Broken home, you know, it should start actually by not having Christ in that family. And then we know in Ephesians chapter 5, I'm just going to read quickly where the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 23. It said, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. And then 24 says, therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husband in everything. Husband, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So in the order of marriage, we have God first, mm-hmm. and we have the man second, and we have the woman, the wife, and then the children. And then in a home that we don't have that God first in that home is always crisis. As I said earlier on in the beginning, once Christ is not in a family, it's crisis. So once there is no order, the man respecting God first in the family, and the man, and then the wife and the children. Once this order is not on, there is always brokenness in that family. Because why? Because the man is not doing his responsibility. One of his responsibility is to being the priest in the house. The man has to be the priest in the house, and you have to lead the rest to follow you. And leave your role as a husband, you are not the priest of the house. You are not training up the children how to read the Bible, personal relationship with God, family altar. We call it family altar. We are not showing that example of family altar. And then you and your wife not showing it to your children. The remedy is that family will go apart. Everybody goes his own way, doing his own thing, not fearing God, not really doing what he or she is supposed to do. So I just leave my husband to continue because of that. We are giving only 15 minutes, but I just want to emphasize again that there is need for the family, which is the father, which is the head of the family, to lead. And then the rest will follow.
Thank you,
Mom. So my husband will continue.
Okay, so I know you have a bunch of questions here for us. And the first question that you had was, what do you think of this term, broken families, broken society? Okay, you want me to on that? And the other ones, you're going to call out the other ones. Am I right? Or
Yes.
Yeah, go ahead.
The second question.
Okay.
The big factor.
Okay, so the second question is, what are some big factors that lead to broken homes? What are some things that may lead to broken homes?
Okay, fine. Like my wife had said, if the order that God has set for the home mm-hmm. not been maintained, if there is anything for whatever reason that is truncating that order, God mm-hmm. and as the head, then the woman as a support, a helpmate, and then the children. If there's anything that leads to that disruption in that order, then these are the things that lead to a broken home. My wife, I talked about the man being the priest of the home, being the one to make sure there is a family altar in the home. Mm. That family altar is maintained on a regular basis. He doesn't have the one to lead all the time.
Right.
But want to ensure that there is a family altar, giving everybody his or her responsibilities. Who leads today? Who leads on Monday, on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday? Okay? When the children are there, when the children are gone, both of them, who is to lead each time? The man is the priest of the home. He also provides the vision for the home. What are we doing at any given time? What's our vision? Where are we going? What's the plan? Okay? He is the one who provides the vision. Is the woman not part of it? Yes, the woman is part of it. But when they discuss, is the man that eventually say, okay, this is where we're going. This is the vision. God's going to share the vision with the woman to make sure that they're all in sync, agreement in the vision. So again, the question is, what are some of the victors that lead to broken home? Broken home is when the man is not playing his role. He doesn't play the role of the priest of the home. And sometimes he has to pray about situations. Everything is not settled on discussion. Sometimes you have to go to God in prayer, agonizing before God to find solutions to situations in the home. Of course, the man has to be the provider for the home. The Bible tells us in Timothy that he who doesn't provide for his home is worse than an infidel. Mm. So he has to be the one to provide for the home. Provide not just the financial provision, security in the home. Reassurance at all times. And have to cover the home. If you are the priest, you cover your family as the man. You cover your family. And the man has to take the high road all the time. That's a difficult thing. Because the man, like he tells us in Colossians, that he should know that the woman is the weaker vessel, in Galatians rather, is the weaker vessel. If he's the weaker vessel, so the man does the more difficult thing. It's more difficult to take abuse and insult. The thing is to fight back. So when the woman is not acting right, when he's saying all kinds of things, take the higher road. That's what the Lord wants you to do. And that is, you are the stronger vessel. You are the one. And these things are not easy. Okay? If I have, we all have to pray together. That is, okay, now that my wife and I were alone at home, we've got to pray together. If we have a misunderstanding, and I say, come, let's pray. I say, no, I'm not going to pray with you. The way you talked to me, I didn't like it. I'm not going to pray with you. And she's going upstairs. And I'm there, I say, okay, but I think I'm right in what I was telling. He said, no, I'm not going to pray with you. You're going to pray by yourself. How can you pray when you've talked to me the way you've talked to me? Okay? And I'm thinking that I'm right. And I'm there wanting to pray. I say, well, the Lord says, go back and call her. Apologize to her and bring her back and pray. At that time, your pride is on the line. You have to swallow your pride. You go and say, I'm sorry. Whether you think you are sorry or not, whether you think you're right or wrong, you got to swallow your pride. These are my own examples. I mean, my own personal experiences. So the man has to do the more difficult thing all the time. If not, if you're not obeying God, you're out of sync with God. And then that's a broken home. So I just want to stop at that. Of course, the children. The Lord says, train our children in the fear of the Lord. We've got to be exemplary in our, you know, talk is cheap. They say, talk is cheap. It's the action. They look at you when things are difficult. What do you do? Children are watching you. Okay? In Ephesians, the children are watching you. So you train the children not only by the family altar, but by your life when things are not there. You say, listen, we're going to trust God. This is not here. We don't have it, but we're going to trust God to believe, to provide this for us. Somebody is sick. They see you lay hands on the person, pray for the person in the family, believing God for healing. They see you do that as the head of the home.
Right.
Now, so these are the things that God, when the man is out of sync, when the woman wants to play the role of the man, that's a problem. Disruption in that order. No matter whom the woman is, no matter how much she earns, no matter how intelligent she is, God does not make you the head of the home. He has made the man the head of the home.
Awesome.
Brilliant ideas. Convince the man with your brilliant idea. Let him come along with you. The man does not always have the best of ideas. Okay? Let me just say this. The boss is not always the boss. I mean, the boss is not always correct, but the boss is always the boss.
Mm-hmm.
President does not have all the ideas all the time. The president of the country, of your company, the president of whatever, he does not have all the best of the ideas.
Right.
President.
Awesome. So that in line with that, you know, that question, the second question, I'm just going to throw this in. It's going to be part of it. And I want us to speed it up. When we talk about one of those big factors, and you mentioned no matter how much the woman earns or no matter how much the man earns. And you mentioned also that a man who is not able to provide is worse than infidel. So what my question there is, what do you think in a practical sense of life when it comes to husband and wife having one account or knowing, you know, accountability in the family, transparency in the area of finance? Because they said finances is one of the things that, you know, bring big issues in marriage.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you cannot trust yourself in finance, then you got a long way to go. If you cannot be open to yourself, to all my accounts, my wife is a signatory to them.
Whoa!
From day one.
Yeah.
She's a signatory to all my, including our business accounts. Mm. Business account. She's a signatory to all of them. She can, she has access to see what is in there every time, anytime.
Hmm.
Accounts, there are some of them I'm not signatories to, unfortunately. It wasn't intentional, but I've never had time to go and add my own signature to that.
You don't want to be a signatory.
Okay? What am I saying? If I can't trust her, mm-hmm. if you can't trust your wife in areas of account, no, nothing.
Right.
So Daddy, this will be the last question. Thank you so much. Like, you know, with the order, a lot of people are listening and they're like, oh, we've missed it. We're not doing it the right way. What advice would you give to them in order to, you know, and they are looking now and they're like, okay, we want to do it right. What advice would you give to like a couple or a family that has realized that they might be in these broken homes, and which is also causing the brokenness in the society?
Well, it's to trust the Lord, go back and make amends. Look at the order, where is it from? You know, make amends. You know, pride in our life is usually the problem. The man is so prideful that he never thinks he's wrong to say, I'm sorry. Okay? Or sometimes the woman thinks it's so right that she never thinks she's wrong. No, let's go back. Recognize that the man is head of the home. That doesn't mean that the man has all the ideas. That means that he's right all the time. No, but he's the head. That means whatever thing, we've got to agree on them. If you don't, I'm not agreeing, pray to God. Ask God, change your prideful life. Everything starts in pride. That's everything starts. We are on our high horses, everybody thinks he's right or she's right. So let's go back to that. And then, of course, if you have a problem with account, be open to yourselves. That's where it becomes. Mm-hmm. You won't need cover any money. Okay? That's my answer to that.
Oh, wow.
Just add one more thing. Let me add one more thing to it. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 7, we always talk about this in my home when we have the little thing. It says about taking the wrong. Mm-hmm. People know that this thing is in the Bible. When you take the wrong of whatever that person has done to you, you know, if you, like, we always read it in our house every time, take the wrong, then we laugh over it. You know, because that's one of our covenants in my church. If anybody has something to you, forgive and take the wrong. And then when you forgive, God is fighting your battle for you. That's what I want to say. That thing helps us a lot in our marital home. So if people will learn how to take the wrong, forgive one another, and move on. Don't give any atom of Satan or snake to come into your house. Amen. Just
awesome. Before you guys drop the floor, I want to say, you know, thank you so much. But let me ask Daddy, if there is somebody here tonight who is listening, this, you know, this broadcast is shared on Facebook and people are over there. We can, you know, see people who are here watching. What advice can you give that young girl, that young man who never had a father, who never had opportunity to be loved as, you know, parents supposed to love their children, and they are struggling and they feel like, you know, life is not fair. They look at people who have parents. So what advice can you give to such a person today before?
My advice is that the Lord Jesus Christ is your father. Understand that he loves you wherever you are, you know, whatever you've done. He loves you so dearly. That's the truth of the matter. God loves you and desires you to change. Whatever you are. If you do not have a father, a physical father, there are people you can look onto. Adopt people who can transform your life. You can adopt people who you can look onto and talk to them. So that's one aspect. First of all, the Lord Jesus Christ, he can father you. Know him as your Lord and Savior. Be on your knees and tell him your needs. You'll be amazed how he communicates with you, how he guides you through life. And then look onto people that you can discuss, you know, personal issues, things that are going on in your life. you know, ask the Lord to prayerfully lead you to people that can mentor you, that can be your spiritual fathers, or people you can adopt and say, hey, I want to adopt you as my father. But you, can you be somebody who can guide me? And you see how God is going to bless you. And then whatever things you've lost, the Lord will restore them to his glory.
Amen.
Wow. This was very powerful. Thank you so much, Daddy and Mommy. We are so grateful. Thank you so much. This is like, it's been a blessing just so far. We're going to go ahead and get to the next section. But before we do that, we just want to break the ice. We have a few questions here that people sent in to us, and we just want to answer them as we go. And one of the questions here is, honey, I think this is our question.
Okay.
How did you feel when you proposed to your wife?
That's
his question.
All right. So he was, I'm not sure I'm ready to say this now, but I'm going to say it. And I didn't know when it'd been in my heart, but when I said it, my heart was pounding. I wanted to see what she's going to say. And when she said yes, I was excited. I couldn't sleep. So it was amazing. I mean, I had that mixed feeling of, overexcited and just, that kind of feeling. I couldn't sleep.
I don't know that kind of feeling. All right. Thank you guys so much. So, honey, you want to go ahead and take the next speaker?
Awesome. So, I have here in our midst tonight a big friend, senior friend. He was one of those people that we looked up to. You know, we served in the same church together until when God, helped him to open his own ministry. And he is a young man full of life. If I tell you his age, you will not believe it. But one thing I'm going to tell you, he's way older than me. But when you look at him, he still looks like under 20. I'm talking about no other person than Dr. Anya. He is a senior pastor of World Changer in Abasso. Pastor Anya, you are welcome to this live broadcast.
Thank you for joining.
Thank you very much. You can hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. I want to wish you a happy ninth anniversary, Candy and Martin. God has brought you this far. He will take you through to the end of your marital experience in a very exciting way.
Yes. Actually, we sent some of these questions ahead of time. We just want to talk about foundations. What is the foundation of a lifelong marriage?
Yeah.
And the questions here are, what is the purpose of marriage? How can we ensure that we are laying a good foundation for a good marriage? And what advice can you give to someone who may think that they started their marriage or their relationship on the wrong foundation, and how can they make it right?
Yes. And Pastor Anya, before you ride on, you remember when we were talking, I used to hear when we were growing up, I hear people say, oh, if you marry the wrong, a wrong wife, you are in hellfire.
Yeah.
And that sets somebody off like, oh, things are not going to be right again. There's a psychological effect to that. Mm-hmm. And people would just complain and say, I have a wrong wife. I have a wrong husband. Yes. So how can we, put this whole thing together tonight for people who are listening, who feel like my wife is stubborn, my wife or my husband is like this, foundation, just looking at marriage all in it, together.
Okay, so let me start this way. You may need to remind me of the last point to come back to this question you just raised now.
What is the purpose of marriage?
Let me start with that.
Okay.
Exactly. So that's the understanding the purpose of a thing is the foundation for success for whatever you're doing. Mm-hmm. You need to know what something is about, and then what is the meaning and the purpose of it. And marriage, the marriage is a relationship between man and God. I mean, between a man and a woman, designed by God to enable them to the deepest level possible, help each other become who God created them to be. I have taken a number of this. So I'll take it again. Marriage is a relationship between one man and one woman designed by God to enable them to the deepest level possible, help each other become who God wants them to be. The reason I have to say to the deepest level possible is because other people can help you. Friends can help you. Parents can help you. Colleagues can help you. But they have a level to which they can go. But God gives you someone now who can be with you and help you to the deepest level possible, become who he created it to be. The Bible says in Genesis 2 and verse 18, it says, so the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I'm going to help him. I'm going to give him someone to help him. So this help is to the deepest level possible. So each one of us is created with a purpose. And God gives you someone who can work with you to help you fulfill that purpose for your life. So the man helps the woman and the woman helps the man. Now, that's on our natural level. There's another higher level. To that level, marriage is a relationship between man and a woman designed by God to demonstrate the world-changing relationship that exists between God and man. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. I'll take it again. Marriage is a relationship between a woman and a man designed by God to show the world-changing relationship between God himself and man. So what a man and a woman are doing is what God and man are supposed to be doing.
Wow.
Right? So if you, in the New Testament language, it says it this way, it's a relationship between Christ and the church. So marriage is the man and the woman having a drama, showing what happens between Jesus and his church. So what that means is that your marriage is not about you. It's about Jesus and his church. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 31. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and they will become one flesh. And then Paul quickly says, this is a great mystery, but I'm speaking concerning Christ and his church. So what you are doing, Martin and Candy, is not about two of you. It's that two of you are reflecting and dramatizing the relationship that is supposed to exist between Christ and his church. So Martin, you are now acting the role of Christ, and Candy, you are acting the role of the church. So it's not about two of you. So how will you make sure this marriage works? It's a very simple thing. If you are doing a play in school, they write a script for you. So you read the script and read your part and play your part. So you don't do what you want to do. You do what the script says you should do. Wow. So if you feel sad, you don't act sad. If the script says act happy. So you deny yourself and obey the script. And so that script tells you what to do. The reason why marriages fail is because people do what they feel. They act out themselves without knowing. Marriage is not about us. It's about God and his church. So I don't do what I want to do. I do what I see God do with the church. So if God is respecting the church and honoring the church, that's what I should do, no matter how I feel about what is going on. So that's the first thing people should know.
Wow.
Is that right?
Very loaded, very loaded. I believe our audience, you know, is very, very, you know, informative and transforming. Pastor Anya, let me throw this second question. You know, how can we ensure that we are laying a good foundation for a long-lasting marriage relationship? You know, how can we do that?
All right. So there's a number of things.
I know you already, you are answering some of the questions, but just to, go ahead.
Yeah. Yes. People need to know very well what's the purpose of this relationship. You'll be surprised that many don't know why they are related. They don't know why they are married. Okay? And it's not even enough to know the purpose of the marriage. You need to be sure that the purpose you think you have is a meaningful one. There are those who are married because they want to have children. Now, if in those kind of marriages, if children don't come or don't come early, they have problems because that was their purpose. Some get married because they want to start having sex. And if they get involved and there are issues around sex, they are not fulfilled because now what they have in mind is not working. So the first purpose that we mentioned, people need to know that this is why we are coming together in the relationship. Number two, people need to understand the process of marriage. You know, in choice making, people don't understand that the process of marriage is superior to the person you are choosing for marriage. Okay? What that means is that people see somebody and they say, oh, I want to marry you. You don't do that. You are guided by God in making a choice. Just because you see someone and like them does not mean you should marry them. You can see somebody and like them, and God says, no, this is not your wife. Mm-hmm. This is not your husband. You should respond to that leading of God. Many people see somebody, like somebody, jump into the relationship, and it was not led by God. So you can see somebody and want to marry them. God says, no, it's not this person. I have someone else to you. People should know, I need to be guided by God in making a choice. It's not just about how I feel. The third thing is that there should be the place of the authority of that marriage. Two persons come together. What's the authority of this relationship? We need to know, as believers, the authority of our relationship is God's word. So we should establish that. Right. What we do is what God's word tell us to do. But in the crazy world we live right now, we watch a lot of movies, we read a lot of books, and then we come into our marriage and we say, well, I watched this movie where this person said, or I read this book where this person said, and we mess up the authority. The Bible has to be our authority, and if we obey the scriptures, it guides us so we don't get messed up in our relationship. And then the final thing I want to mention is that the man needs to know his role in the relationship, and the woman needs to know her role in the relationship, because God has already planned this thing out so that people have roles. And the role of the woman is clearer in the Bible than the role of the man. But the man's role is there. The woman's role, we know, is to submit. We understand that. It's submission. Okay? But the way we interpret submission, we don't understand what it is. Because the man's role is more serious than the woman's role of submission. The man's role is service. The woman is to submit to the man, but the man is to serve the woman. Okay? So, bring it to the scriptures. Remember, the man is acting Christ. The Bible, Jesus said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Now, the man should serve and give his life, and it's by that service that he provokes the submission of the woman. You never command your wife to submit. You end that submission by service. It is like somebody being a medical doctor who has spent all the years getting the training to be a medical doctor. Now you are certified. You have a clinic now. Patients come to your clinic who readily submit to you for treatment because they now trust you, the sacrifice you have made to be in this position that you are right now. So when the man learns to serve and love with all his heart, the woman submits to that service, the marriage becomes a beautiful one.
Awesome. Wow. I don't feel like stopping you, but I have to stop you, Pastor Anya. Let's take the last question. And this last question,
all right.
It says, what advice can you give to someone who think they started their relationship, they feel like the foundation is not solid? A few weeks ago, just about 2 weeks ago, we've had couples reach out to us. In fact, last week also, and somebody would tell me, tell us something like this. Oh, we've been staying together and there was no, traditional, legal, any kind of a thing. And we've been together for 5 years. Yes. And we've had like a child or two kids. Are we married? We have questions like that. So what advice do you have for people who feel like their foundation is not right? What can you, what can they do?
All right. Okay. I want to connect that to what you mentioned at the beginning where people are told that if you make a mistake in marriage, you are going to be in hell. They mean well, but they misrepresent the truth. You cannot have Jesus in your life. And somebody will tell you, but if you have made a mistake, it is final. It can never be. If you have made a mistake in your relationship and you still have Jesus in your life, I thought that what we are taught is that you can make all things right. So what you need to do when you want to begin to correct, you go right back to Jesus and we now put this back together. In fact, even if you married the wrong person, Jesus, God has a way of making the wrong person the right person. Let me give you an idea. It was never God's design for David and Bathsheba to be married. That was completely wrong. But when David repented and came back to God in his sanity, God reconstructed that relationship and made his relationship with Bathsheba to become right. It started in evil, but it ended in righteousness. That was why, after the first child of that relationship died, it was God now that adopted the second son of that relationship, who was Solomon, and actually said, "This is now my own delighted son." Okay? So you could start in error, and God can make things turn out all right. So how do you do that? The way to do that is to go back and look at yourself. Where do we start? Okay, look at, do we know what the purpose of this relationship is? We can sit back down and try to reconstruct it, try to understand it. Do we have an authority for this relationship? We need to go back and get it right. Are we led by God in how we interact with ourselves? We go back and let that right. Are we relating with ourselves in the proper roles? We go back and let that right. If you just know where you're not doing well, start from somewhere. You can't correct everything overnight, but start somewhere. If you're already with somebody and you know that we have not done the right things, do the right things now. Go and meet the parents. You don't just meet someone on the road and marriage is not just about the two of you, it's about God. There has to be a proper process for, you know, contracting this thing. So if you're already making a mistake, it's not fine now. You can recover. Just stop and then start from whatever step you are missing and do the things right back.
Awesome. Wow. Very loaded. Pastor, before I let you go, can you tell us how many years you've been married?
This 25th of April is our 17th year of marriage.
Awesome. All right. Daddy. Yeah, I'm good. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Yeah. Daddy,
can... Daddy and Mommy Lizzie.
How many years have you all been married? Okay.
39 years so far. Yes. December this year is going to be 40 years.
Wow.
Wow.
That's amazing. That's amazing. I have so many big uncles here. We're excited and we're going to hear a lot of other stories. But honey, I give it up to you right now.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Anya. We are so grateful for this. And, you know, most times we go into things and we just don't understand what we're going into. So you just kind of gave us a clear definition of what marriage is all about. And If anyone on here, you are not married, before you get married, now you know why you should be married. Right. It's just that question, why am I married? Or why am I getting married?
Right.
You know, and sometimes you go in there and you're like, okay, this was not what I expected.
Right.
And having that knowledge of the purpose of marriage, I think it's just one thing for you to know why you are doing what you're
right.
doing.
Right, and that relates to what we normally say, marriage is not just only about finding the right person, but becoming the right person.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, so I really appreciate you for these words of wisdom. Guys, a round of applause wherever you are. Just if you are on Facebook, give us an emoji and, you know, just appreciate the man of God for blessing us today, guys. We are so happy to be blessed by you. Thank you, sir. All right, so we're going to go to the next speaker. This next speaker, they are, you know, what we say, fresh off the boat. You know, they just got married. So, and we're just so excited that Okwi and Tyler was able to join us today. They got married last year, yes. And I feel like it's just a blessing to be able to hear from them, from their own perspective or point of view about what marriage is all about, or things that they've learned in just these few months that they've been married. And we're just so blessed to welcome them. But before we do, we're going to take another question or another, you know, interaction. I'm going to ask him a question and maybe he can ask me back. I'm not sure, but this is just going to be us doing this. So, honey, if you had one word to describe our love, what would it be?
That's a good one. I will say progress.
Oh, that's beautiful.
But in another word, I can call it slow and steady, because it's been a long year. I don't know if anybody can agree with me. You know, the most important thing is that we are making progress. We are heading, we are moving, right, you know, towards the right position. Amen. It hasn't been, you know, like run. No, it's been a slow and steady journey, and we are grateful that it's turning out good for us.
Yeah. I think what you're saying is that it's a marathon, not a sprint, right?
Whoa, you reminded me what I... Yeah.
So we're just taking it easy, and I think it's just all about growing and learning each other. But for me, I would say it has been eventful.
Wow.
I think eventful in a way that I am gradually just learning things, you know, and then just understanding how things work.
And doing a whole lot of things, a lot of activities, kids, yes.
It's been eventful.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right, guys. And now we're just going to welcome the newest couple in town. Right. Well, maybe they're not, but we just want to welcome Pastor Tyler and Okwi Banhan for them to speak to us. Hey, guys. We are so
excited. Hi. Hey, everybody.
All right. So, you know, for the audience, if you can tell us who you are, tell us what you're, you know, how long you've been married, and then we'll go from there.
Right.
Go ahead.
Nice. So, like Candy and Martin already said, we are, I'm Okwi, and this is my husband, Tyler Van Horn. And we've only been married for a little over 8 months, almost nine.
Awesome.
In September of last year. So, right before COVID, just in time.
I'm a medical mission.
But thank you so much for inviting us to be part of this. You know, we are very new, but marriage has definitely been a lot of learning and definitely a gift from God. So we're just honored to be joining the conversation with you guys. And happy anniversary.
Yeah, happy anniversary.
Thank you. Awesome.
All right. So, the question that we, you know, we spoke before now, we just want to know what your perspective is, because we all know getting into something, we have some sort of expectation. I always say your expectation may not really be equal to reality.
Right.
And our question here is, for you, what are the things that you wish you knew before marriage? And what is one thing that you're doing to help you to get back in on track on this whole godly couple? Because our whole purpose of what we do is that we are, you know, doing what God wants us to do. We are representing Jesus. We're representing God in every aspect of our lives. And that is part of our relationship, our marriage. We wanted to mirror what God wants us to do. So the question first is, what is it that you wish you knew? What is it that you're learning in marriage that you knew before you got married?
That's a lot of question, baby.
Okay, listen.
So I guess we can talk about what we wish we knew first.
You want me to go first?
Yeah, sure.
One thing that I wish I knew before marriage is how much is really not about me. You know, as a single man, you know, you only have to think about yourself, really. Like, it's a little different being a Christian, because you don't just always think about yourself. You think about others, yes. But a single man, it's about what I need, you know. Like, I'm a shoe guy. So I never thought about, like, buying shoes before. I was just like, if I want shoes, I'm just going to go buy shoes. Like, think nothing of it. I'm just going to do it. And now I'm sitting here, like right before we got married, I bought a pair of shoes. And it was the first time I was like, I wish I knew that before coming into it, because it would have canceled out a lot of arguments. Like, for sure, it would have ended a lot of things we have fought about in the past. Because, you know, when you get married, one of the biggest things you fight about is money sometimes. So I'm like, you know, if I knew that it was really about her, and everything was tailored toward taking care of my wife. Like, that's it. I need to tailor my expectations to taking care of her. And if I would have started that earlier, I feel like our marriage, like in these early years, is going to be so much smoother, because I've learned this so soon.
Awesome. Wow. You're ahead of time. I'm just going to tell you that. You're catch up this. You are really ahead of time, because there have been couples that have been married 10 years. They've not understood this simple principle. So good job.
Thank you.
I'm trying. You're welcome.
Something that I think would have been really good to know before getting married is just that, okay, because we took a pre-married class, we had some counselors, and we were going back and forth, like, should we be saving for a house, should we be renting, all this stuff. And so I've heard from different people, like, that if you like stay with any of your parents or like your in-laws, that it'll just be like the worst nightmare of your life. And so I remember like being very afraid to like go to our parents, like, hey, we have this idea that we want to be saving towards buying a house, but everybody around me has told me, like, don't like ask your parents for any help, you know, it's like leave and cleave, you're on your own. And I was like very afraid that we would just like, I don't know, throw ourselves to the wolves if we were like, hey, mom and dad, or like even with his parents, can you help us make this like vision a reality in our future? And I think like it was just comforting after we got married that right now we're saving for a house, but we live with his parents, and God be the glory. Like, it has been such a blessing for us. And I just like, if anyone's watching and you're young and you don't have like all the money in the bank and you're not well established already, like your family, even though you're married, like they're still your family. And I remember, like, because I'm Nigerian, my parents are just like my best friends, you know, like my brothers, I do everything with them. So I was just kind of nervous about, with the cultural difference, are we gonna have to like, you know, separate and create our own thing? But thankfully, even with his parents being invested in us, it's just been so good to know, like, even if you've heard horror stories, like, oh, I had to separate from my in-laws, or, you know, I butted heads with my mom when we lived together. Like, if you are prayerful and like you're just trusting God, he does make a way where there seems to be no way. So we've saved so much money. And so if you've just gotten married, don't feel any pressure. Don't feel embarrassed. Like, save your money. Be smart. Be smart, because yes, no shame. No shame. Okay.
Awesome. Go ahead, baby.
Wow, thank you so much for sharing. So the last question is, what is one thing that you both are doing to, you know, keep, to be on track as a godly couple?
I'll go first again.
Yeah.
I think one thing that is big for us to keep us on track and keep us moving forward, not only in our marriage, but with our relationship with Christ, we have to be in the Word together, and we have to be praying together, and we have to, even one thing, I'm in ministry, so I work at a church, right? One of the biggest problems I've had working at a church is sometimes overlooking the assembly with my wife, like, because I'm always trying to serve, trying to do this at the church, do that at the church, be involved in the church. I sometimes forget I need to sit in a service with her. I need to sit in a worship atmosphere with her, and we need to praise God together in that atmosphere with the body of believers. So just one thing I'm making sure I'm doing is not only that we're reading and praying together and studying God's word, but also like we're not forsaking the gathering of believers together. Like, we are together and united and worshiping God together inside of his church, inside of his house. It's really changed these early years of our marriage, because when we first got married, we were bad at it. And now we've gotten better. Praise yes. God, we have gotten better.
Thank God. I think something that's been very, very helpful for us, this is kind of more a practical step, and so maybe a lot of people haven't heard of this, but before I even got married to Tyler, I followed this couple that I really admired, and their names are Jeremy and Audrey Roloff. So I went ahead and ordered this journal. It's called The Navigator's Counsel. And so something that we do, It's really simple. It's six of the same questions every week, but it creates the open conversation between you and your spouse so that if you just choose one day out of the week, like maybe Saturday or whatever your Sabbath is, that you sit and have the conversation. What was something that brought you joy? What was hard for you this week? Is there any hidden sin or something that I need to apologize for? And having that opportunity just to ask each other those questions every single week has kept us on track. Like, even if we feel disconnected one day, we know we're going to come back together and say, okay, what can we do better financially? Even in our intimacy, like, we have to have those conversations so that we're continuing to move forward and open with each other in our communication. So that's just a practical thing that I think has really helped us in our early months of marriage, just stay open and honest with one another.
Absolutely. Communication is key to everything.
Yeah.
Communication is key. If you're not talking, you're doing it all wrong. Nice.
Wow, you guys are such a lovely and beautiful couple.
Amazing.
And we have been just so blessed just listening to the two of you. If you don't mind, I know some people might be wondering, where can I get this book? Or, because, you know, I think it's so practical and it will help a lot of us. If you don't mind, you know, letting me know where I can get the book so I can share with people that are watching, so that can be a blessing to
them. Yes,
absolutely. Yes. I'll definitely share it with you all.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Pastor Taylor and Opie.
Right.
We are so blessed to have you guys here.
Thank you.
We are just pretty much rounding up,
right,
because we don't want to keep everyone here, but we are so glad that every one of you have joined. The next thing that we want to do is to take more questions from people.
Right.
Some people sent in questions before now, and we'll see Daddy and Mommy Lizzie and Dr. Anya, we would see some of these questions. We'd like for you all to tackle it if we're not able to.
Yeah, we just make it very snappy and brief.
All right, great. So the first question, and the question I want to say says, how do you forgive in a marriage and not forget what you do when the man is not an accountability person? Eddie, if you can take that one. Like, how do you in a marriage and not forget if the person is not accountable? I think that's probably what the question is saying.
My understanding, how do you forgive without remembering what was done? That's my understanding of the question.
Even if the person is not showing, you know, being... taking, you know, responsibility.
Oh, I see. For
what is happening.
Well, no doubt about it. Sometimes, like we've had, it takes the grace of God. Because if somebody apologizes for something, is doing the same thing over and over, what do you do? You got to go to him, and he might grant you the grace. And not just granting you the grace, and you determine, you know this, I am going to, because the Bible said, how many times will my brother sin against me? He said that,
seven times
in a day, isn't it right? So,
nine times,
decide, you know what? I'm going to ignore this. Lord, grant me the grace to ignore this. What if you have a partner that is, persistently doing one thing that provokes you and talked about it, but it's still occurring? That's where you need the grace of God. That's where you need prayers. Praise God. I think that's my answer to that.
Well, thank you, Daddy, for answering that question. I have a question for you, Dr. Anya Oko. I think one of the questions here is, how do you... He said something about... Some marriages are not working anymore. Some couples divorce each other because of a child issue after waiting for a few years. Now, what would make a marriage that has lasted for 9 years without a child, yet they still live together as though they are still in their honeymoon?
Okay. So this is like somebody's surprised that people are married for 9 years, no child. Yeah. And they are still staying together. Like saying, what on earth is making them still stay together?
Right.
Or that kind of thing, right? All right.
Yes.
So the thing is to understand that children are not the purpose of marriage. they are not the purpose of marriage. Children are an addition to marriage. Marriage is complete with or without children. It's about the man and the woman. So if you understand that, it's Christ and the church. If they come together, that's all right. Children now are a gift, you know. So if somebody knows that, you can now know, okay, God gives us children. That's beautiful. We expect that. But if we don't have children, that has not tarnished this relationship. It is still complete. That's something people need to understand.
Awesome.
Well, I think that's the last question.
So yes. So that's the last question we have here today. And
I think I have a question.
You have another question
for you?
For me? Okay.
Okay. The question is, what are you doing positively every day to affect each other's life? What are you doing to affect my life every day?
First of all, like Dr. Anyoko already said, understanding the purpose of marriage helps you. My number one calling, you know, I believe that God has put me in your life to help you fulfill your purpose in life. And for me, we do it in different ways. We pray together. I hold her accountable. Like, we have to pray and fast. I mean, praying and fasting has been something. It's not like, you know, if you are not fasting, you know, you are not a child of God, but I encourage you to start developing that discipline. My wife, she loves to eat as much as I do too. You know, I have to hold her, you know, and she is now doing well, saying, "Hey, honey, today is our praying and fasting." Yes. So it's been something, you know, some spiritual discipline just growing together in different areas. So it's been, yeah, just helping you becoming all that God has called you to be. And for you, what can you say that has, you know, you are doing in my, you know, to impact me positively?
Yes. Well, I think I'm naturally an encourager and motivator. And I think I see that every single day, helping you to take care of yourself.
Wow.
I feel like I've put it upon myself to make sure that, you know, he does what he needs to do. Wow. I mean, not in a bad way, but of course I have to learn to submit under him, but helping him not to procrastinate, because my husband could be a person who would tell you I will get something done,
right,
but he may not end up doing it
right
for a long time. But I feel like I have been put in his life to help him to get done.
Right.
You know, I feel like I'm more of a tax oriented, and he's like a people oriented. So we kind of get that personality a lot. So I've understood what his personality is like, and he's learning to understand mine, I'm hoping. And so I feel like I am, you know, there to help.
Right.
She
is my police. That's what this is.
All right. Thank you guys so much. Thank you. Thank you for our guests. We are so grateful. Thank you, Daddy and Mommy Lizzie. Thank you, Dr. Anyoko. Thank you, Tyler and Opie. We are so grateful that you guys joined us. So we're going to wrap up now. Before now, we had, we're going to have a toast, right?
Right.
And afterwards, we're going to give away. We had some giveaway that we'll be giving to our live audience. And if your name gets picked and you are not online, I'm sorry, we may have to forfeit that to be able to give to people that are currently online.
Right.
So that's what we're going to do. So, honey?
So I have a friend here. My brother, he calls me brother for life. He's been such an amazing friend, even though last year he was pulled out of my life, you know, closely. You know, he's no longer in Atlanta, but we still keep in touch. He's now in New York. I'm talking about my friend Michael.
Okay, Michael,
yeah, over to you right now.
So we're going to toast. If you're online and you have your video, just grab a cup and water. It's fine. Or you can get wine.
Right,
it's okay.
Right.
Let's toast together.
Right.
And, you know.
Are you there, Nonso?
Yes. Wow. We are here. Hello, everyone.
And it's good to see everybody. Mom, Dad, Auntie Dapo, everybody. Hello, Okpi. Good to see you guys. And of course, if you have something to drink, a cup, please pull it forward. We're going to toast. We're going to give maybe
I'm driving.
About 40 seconds.
Hey, Uncle.
Hey, Uncle.
From Abuja. I'm on the wheel.
Okay.
Yeah. But I'll be following you guys, man.
Yes. Hey.
Okay.
All right. So we just want to use this opportunity to say happy our wedding anniversary to our brother Martin and our sister Chi.
Thank you.
You guys so much. We thank God that we are celebrating this 9 year of wedding anniversary. And we pray that God will continue to add fresh anointing to your marriage now and forevermore. So let's cheers to that. Let's raise our glasses. And cheers to Chi and Martin.
Awesome.
Many more beautiful years ahead.
Cheers. Amen. I wanted to hear the voice of the angel beside you, please.
Congratulations, Martin and Chi. It's wonderful that you are celebrating 9 years of marriage. I pray that the years coming will be more beautiful than the ones that have gone by.
Amen.
You continue to have joy, love, laughter in your marriage in Jesus' name.
Amen. Just to that was good.
Awesome.
Life, jeez.
All right, so thank you, mommy. Okay, so we're going to be rounding up. So, honey.
Yeah, we feel like, you know, this is virtual party. If we were doing it live, we definitely would, you know, have some food, you know, things that, you know, we're going to have to refresh the people that will come for the event. But we decided to just give because we understand that life is all about giving, not taking. So we just want to encourage some couples and single people, you know, to have a time out for themselves. I know that we are in the middle of pandemic, but things are opening up, so you can just take your wife, you can take your couple out and just have a lunch or a dinner, whatever it is. So we decided to give out. So right here, I have some names put together. So my beautiful wife, we'll just go ahead and pick and we'll announce those who are participating for this giveaway.
Okay, so we're
no.
All right, thank you guys so much for joining us. We're just so happy that you are here, and thank you for all our guest speakers. Thank you, Mommy Dapo. Thank you for those on Zoom.
Right.
You know, honey. All the people that are there, we're really so grateful that you joined us, and thank you for participating today.
Right.
We'd love to see what you all think about having this on a monthly basis.
That's what we've been thinking. So if we're gonna have it again, we'll let you know.
Yes.
We've been praying about it. We felt like this is gonna be something that we'll be doing more often. Maybe have one speaker at a time so that they can have the time to unleash all they have for us. Thank you all for joining today. We are so grateful, and we're going to pray us out. And at this time, I want to call on a beautiful couple. These are our Uncle Dayo Ekundaye Falase. They're going to pray us out. I thank you all for joining, and I appreciate your presence, even sticking to the end of this event.
Thank you
once again, Pastor Anya. Thank you, Daddy Obiekwe and Mommy Lizzie. Thank you for those joining on Facebook. We really, really appreciate your presence here today. God bless you for coming to honor us. And we just pray that God will continue to strengthen our relationship. We believe that this is what God has called us to do, to help marriages and family to heal and just become all that God has called them to be. So over to you, Uncle Dial and Mommy.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you
for your goodness towards each and every one of us. We thank you for the ministry that you have given our dear friend, Brother Martin, and brother and sister Achiri. Thank you very much for your love for them, and thank you, Lord, for the time you have taken them through to have that experience to bestow on other people. Thank you for the diversity that we have had here, people of varying number of years of marriage. Thank you for the experiences that have been brought forward. And thank you for your inspiration towards each and every one of us present tonight. I pray, our Heavenly Father, that you will continue to solidify our marriages, Lord, those from Nigeria and those from other places in the world that have joined tonight. I pray, my Heavenly Father, that you will be with them. May you be with their marriages, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that this mission will continue to grow and grow and reach the outermost part of the world, Lord. Amen. And we exalt you, we praise you, give them good health, give them a solid conviction of you, that you are the Lord of all marriages, Lord. You constitute marriages. And I pray, Lord, that whatever problem or situation we are in, we will bring it to you, the Lord God Almighty, the author and finisher of our faith. We pray as we depart tonight that we will depart in peace and we'll continue to exalt you. In Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Amen. Thank you so much. We're gonna start playing some music.
You are free to leave, but for those on Facebook, we're gonna, you know, play some music here, and me and my wife will be dancing in here.
Thank you for having us. Nice to see everyone. Thank you.
Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary. All right.
Happy anniversary.
Martin, thank you. Candy, thank you. Happy anniversary. Bye bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anya.
You can put your music.
Thank you.